Hey everybody, this is Way to Fail, and today I'm going to be discussing the current issues surrounding YouTube's recent multi-channel network change, copyrights, and what it all means. Please keep in mind the disclaimer in the description and at the start of this video. This video is meant for entertainment purposes only and is not meant to be legal advice or the basis for an attorney-client relationship. I will not be answering specific legal questions in the comments. By now you have probably heard a lot of uproar surrounding YouTube's December 9th policy change for how multi-channel networks are managed. In a nutshell, one of the major benefits of joining a network was getting away from YouTube's automated copyright bots that go through uploaded content. They're a hassle to deal with, but we'll talk about them in a minute. YouTube's change requires multi-channel networks to split into tiers that include managed channels, which will continue to receive the same protection they always have, and affiliate channels, which have been left out to dry. It is a substantial change. It's created a huge public outcry. But who's the good guy here? Who's the bad guy? Who can we all blame for this? And where can we get our torches and pitchforks? In this video, I'm going to break through the bullshit. I'll warn you though, in my day job, I often have to deliver some bad news, even if I know it's going to piss off my client. If you're a YouTube Let's Player watching this for reassurance, you better buckle your britches. There's a lot to take in, and most of it is bad news. There are three angles that I'm going to need to break down on this issue, and I'm going to discuss them in this order. First, the rights of a Let's Player under U.S. copyright law, the law that's most relevant to YouTube as Google is an American corporation. Second, the current copyright landscape and YouTube's policy change for multi-channel networks. And third, why different multi-channel networks are starting to pass the buck onto their content creators. Strapped in? Good, let's go. First, copyright law. I previously made a video on this channel discussing it, and you can watch it again if you want, but I'll warn you the audio fidelity sucks. So here's the breakdown again. When you create something, that thing, whether it's in a book or in a painting or a piece of programming code, it's subject to copyright law. In the USA, the creator of the work by default owns the copyright, which gives him or her a bundle of rights, including controlling commercialization of the work and redistribution of the work. You don't have to register a copyright, although generally it's a good idea to do so, but even if you don't, it's there by law. So let's say you want to make a Let's Play video for a recently released game. Whatever you create in the video, you own. Did you do audio commentary? You own that. Did you make some snazzy introduction? You own what you put into that. Face cam? If you don't have a bunch of copyrighted shit in the background, that's yours too. Congratulations. You have a valid copyright claim on your entire Let's Play video. You win. End of video, right? Wrong. Did you create the code for the game that generates a specific audio-visual experience? No. Did you create graphic assets for the game? No. Did you compose the music? Voice acting? No. Are you screwed? Possibly. Oh, and for those of you who did create the game yourself and want to do a Let's Play, please check and make sure that someone else does not have distribution or reproduction rights as well. That can get messy. But yes, you are possibly screwed. If you have permission to make a Let's Play video from a publisher or content creator, then at least under copyright law, you're okay. If you have authorization to use the video commercially, aka monetization on YouTube, then under copyright law, you're okay. Keep in mind this is copyright law, not necessarily under YouTube's policy. We'll get to that later. Express permission fixes a lot of problems that could arise under the law. However, if you do not have express permission, your Let's Play video may fall under fair use. Now there's a weighty, heavily litigated, often misunderstood doctrine. I'm not going to belabor the four-factor test and all the court cases that go with them. Instead, I'm just going to do a quick drive-by application of each of the factors based on what I typically see in Let's Play videos, which is a straight-up playthrough or sequential montage of gameplay accompanied by audio commentary. Remember, you might be some special snowflake, and your content that you create may weigh differently in these factors. There are plenty of copyright attorneys out there who will happily consult you on your specific case and your specific facts for a fee. As always. Now the four fair use factors are as follows. 1. The purpose of the video. 2. The nature of the copyrighted source material. 3. How much of the source material you use. And 4. The effect of the use on the market and the value of the work. Let's get started. Purpose. A typical Let's Play video that tries to qualify under this factor pretty much immediately fails it. Whether or not you're monetizing the video, even people who just set out to entertain instead of make money off of it fail. 2. Let's Play videos are oftentimes not commentary or criticism on the nature of the game, but instead are just people talking over what they're doing while playing the game or screaming gibberish at the screen. That's not enough. Slapping your own voice work, which you do on your own, over an otherwise unchanged playthrough of a game is not transformative. So generally, Let's Play videos fail on this factor. They especially fail if they're monetized, but even if not, they usually fail. Nature of the work. Works of fiction and creative works receive much greater protection under copyright law than nonfiction. And under Brown versus Entertainment Merchants Association, which I really, really wish was still called Schwarzenegger versus EMA. But anyway, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that video games qualify for First Amendment protection because they are creative works like books and movies. Copyright law is rooted in statute and in the First Amendment. Pretty much every Let's Player loses on this factor, even if your Let's Play is of the game Number Munchers. Third factor, the amount of the work. A typical Let's Play plays through an entire game straight through. The meat and potatoes, the heart and soul of the game, is played out over a YouTube window with some LPer voicing over their 2 cents. Now, some Let's Players are very entertaining at giving their 2 cents, and we can give them a cookie. But US copyright law doesn't care how hilarious you are if you are plowing through the game straight through the heart of the entire creative work. You lose this factor. Fourth factor, the effect on the market. Oh, the effect on the market. This is the benefit of Let's Plays that I keep hearing about the most. Not just from Let's Players, but from independent developer giants of the world like Notch and Macmillan and others. Let's Play videos have a very positive effect on game sales due to their great exposure to these indie devs that they might not otherwise have received, especially without big marketing budgets. You win on this factor, right? No. The law also considers Sega and Nintendo and other major publishers that people have been shitting on for so long. They're big, they're powerful, how dare they cry about people watching gameplay on YouTube instead of paying $60 for AAA Zombie Titty Gore Fest 2000X. Don't forget to get the $80 Day 1 DLC pre-order today! Well, cutting off a Day 1 sale is not the only contemplation for the effect test. The law also cares about how many copies of the game are available for distribution, and if it's on Steam, that's a lot. The law also cares about corporate waste on marketing due to lost sales, and maybe most significantly to small developers or publishers, the law cares about the tail of the game's sales. The sales that are after that initial influx, after the initial bum rush to buy it off of or watch it rot on the store shelves. Yes, the day one sales of a game are a huge influx of capital, but the lifeblood of any business is the sustainable income that comes afterwards. Again and again, the concern of the courts is that things like Let's Play videos may cut off the tail. They may deter purchases after the game has been available for some time. And considering YouTube can theoretically keep your Let's Play video online for 70 years after the death of the author, or 95 years after its publication, if made by a corporation, and guess what? Most games are made by corporate entities, and that's the time frame needed for the game to enter the public domain. Your Let's Play video could be having an effect on the market well beyond your lifetime. In other words, a game publisher is well within their legal rights to argue Let's Play videos have a negative effect on the market, no matter how much internet karma you can get for complaining about the big boys. But if this factor seems to weigh in your favor, and if it really seems like a small developer is encouraging people to Let's Play their game, chances are you won't need to go through these stupid, bloated, fair use, forest, jungle, whatever you want to call it, because you can usually get permission already just by going to their website, looking for what their blanket statement is, their blanket policy, or even just opening up a tab in your browser, shooting an email straight to the publisher, and getting express permission. You want to avoid fair use as much as possible if you're Let's Playing, because as I said before, these four factors are weighed together on an ad hoc case-by-case basis. Every video is different, every game is different, but 9 times out of 9.5, absent express permission from the content creator, a typical YouTube Let's Play video is going to fail to qualify for fair use. A typical Let's Play video that you do not have permission from is very likely to violate US copyright law as it stands today. I told you I'd be giving you some bad news. Now think about it. Think about it from Google's perspective. That gets us to point two. Now, why in the hell would Google force multi-channel networks to change how they manage their member channels? The short answer? The Digital Millennium Copyright Act. The overriding factor? Money, as always. The Digital Millennium Copyright Act is a piece of law that attempted to fix a bunch of holes in copyright law created by emerging technologies. How wonderful. Unfortunately, it was written by a bunch of old people who were paid and otherwise received under the table or over the table or in the VIP room benefits also known as lobbying, from corporations who had vested interest in forming and shaping the law. The law is a broken, burning piece of shit. This is not a controversial opinion. This is the overriding opinion of many legal scholars who have spilled gallons of ink, hoping and urging courts to beat back the law back towards a pre-DMCA state. But that's another matter for another time. What does suck for Google, and what does suck for many YouTubers who have been complaining about this, is that DMCA takedown notices are incredibly easy to draft and send out, and are stupidly expensive to fight and incredibly irritating to deal with. Why does a DMCA takedown notice matter to Google on YouTube? Because if Google ignores it, they could be liable. Now, Google has deep enough pockets to cover court fees and everything, but they don't want to risk being shut down, and trust me, if they ignore the deluge of DMCA requests they get every single day, they would get shut down. As a result, Google's copyright policies are more stringent than the law requires. That's why when I said before, if your video satisfies copyright law, doesn't always mean it'll satisfy Google's requirements. This is a fail-safe measure to avoid liability on Google's end. They're a private corporation, they're allowed to do this. And YouTube's solution to the threat of DMCA takedown notices and other adverse copyright actions is their highly efficient and totally responsible and reasonable automated process for flagging videos for third-party content and copyrighted content. It's so efficient and reasonable, I very nearly had to take down some of the videos I did for The Swapper, an independently developed game by Facepalm Games that was blocked from being monetized, even though I had a letter from the publisher granting express permission to both LP and monetize the videos. Every YouTuber has or will have their sob story. That makes for good clickbait, but under the law, the DMCA will gladly take your tears on the way to holding you and Google liable for infringement. That's how the law's designed. Now, this is the part where I remind you that Google is not your special friend. Google is a corporation, and a corporation's number one goal revolves around self-preservation. Just ask Susan G. Komen for the cure. And self-preservation includes avoiding legal liability. And with certain game publishers and other media conglomerates beginning to bitch and moan about YouTube content, not just Let's Players, Google is tightening the leash on multi-channel networks in order to better ensure that copyright violations are not occurring over YouTube. Is it a perfect system? Hell no. But it's the system that we have right now. Now, before the change, channels and multi-channel networks are typically not part of Google's wonderful, tantalizing automated copyright sweeping process. That meant that there are a sizable chunk of content creators who receive minimal, if any, monitoring, and apparently someone has gotten really pissed off about them because they wanted their cheese. So what's the reality now? In a post-change world, more of YouTube's content is going to be subject to an intrusive and flawed copyright check process. Google survives and will get to happily take their and continue to take their cut of your monetized video revenue that somehow manages to survive said process. And now there are a number of channels that are part of multi-channel networks that have been downgraded to affiliate status, meaning they get the blunt end of the stick, as it were. Which gets to point three, multi-channel networks and the little guy, the guy that nobody seems to want to step up and defend. Well, guess what, little guy, bend over, this is going to hurt. Let's start with a common scenario. A content creator gets approached by a headhunter or a recruiter to join their network or organization. Finally, the content creator can go from scraping by doing the solo to having an umbrella to give him some safety and security in an otherwise risk-filled world. On YouTube, sometimes this can be someone's big break. For others, they don't know what the hell they're doing but are excited that their work is being recognized by somebody and click on the first network that offers them something and snatches them up. Does this scenario sound familiar to you? Is it at all analogous to the music industry, the theater industry, or any form of entertainment? That's right. Welcome to Entertainment Industry 101. You will find some of the worst, most unscrupulous contracts you can imagine in the entertainment industry. Lock someone down for 5 years, 10 years, pay you a paltry cut of only some of the content you make, keep you from working with a competing organization. It happens with YouTube multi-channel networks just like it happens with everybody else. So let's say you're watching this video and you're one of the unfortunate many who have been downgraded from managed status to affiliate status. You want to know if you're screwed or if there's anything you can do to break the contract that you have based on change of circumstances. Well, I can't answer that question because I don't know your contract, and I'm not going to answer your specific legal question because this video is not an offer or solicitation for legal services. Did you read the disclaimer? I hope you did. But what I can tell you is that multi-channel networks are very much like Google, and that they pay very close attention to their bottom line and are most concerned about survival. Multi-channel networks make money when you make content. That's the benefit they get for running the channels. In exchange, they're responsible for handling much of the nonsense that would keep you from creating your content, which on YouTube is usually along the lines of DMCA takedown notices, copyright strikes, etc., etc. I cannot speak for people who run multi-channel networks. I'm sure the change Google has imposed on them has worried plenty of them about the domino effect of people leaving their networks, but that so many multi-channel networks are putting so many of their smaller content creators on affiliate status is also a sign that they care more about self-preservation than protecting the little guy. Once again, welcome to Entertainment Industry 101. You're useful until you're not, and then you're gone, and someone else is going to take your place. Lots of people are stuck in shitty contracts without the protection that was the entire basis of signing the contract to begin with. Of course, there's going to be a lot of rage and backlash, but from the multi-channel network's perspective, think about it, cutting off the chaff from the big hitters and the high revenue producers is likely a better alternative than having to shut doors entirely due to too many copyright strikes. Like I said, I can't speak for all channels. Some of them are moving everyone over to affiliate status blindly. Some are moving people to manage status based on their copyright status. It's a crapshoot. It's a mess. But obviously, as of today, where we are right now, everyone is trying to get theirs while they still can. But in the next few months, expect the landscape of multi-channel networks to change significantly. Oh, what? Stop with this reasonable look at all sides bullshit. Who are we supposed to be pissed off at all this? Whose house are we tearing down? Point the finger at as many people as you want. Google pulling the rug sucks, but it's their flawed copyright claims process that's the real pisser. How about blaming the people who are abusing the system and using content that they should not have been using to begin with? Or how about blaming people who are sending stupid DMCA notices? Or how about blaming the corporations who are too focused on profit lines and profit margins to change with emerging technologies instead of embracing them? Here's looking at you, Blockbuster. How about blaming numerous multi-channel networks who wrote shitty contracts for the Let's Players either because they had no idea what the fuck they were drafting? It's just a form document, I swear, is not an excuse. Or they knew exactly what they are doing. Once again, welcome to Entertainment Industry 101. Everyone is to blame. No two people are not on fire. Except, of course, for content creators who brave the storm and try to follow the rules as best they can. Look, there's a lot of good people out there making great content on YouTube, and for some, putting on huge clouds over their livelihood is an unnecessary stress. It sucks. But the sun is going to rise tomorrow, and eventually these clouds will pass, and we'll be in a new normal where someone gets their shit together. Multi-channel networks adopt new policies or lose their content creators entirely, or some new challenger emerges to compete with YouTube and forces YouTube to change their ways. We can dream, right? So this is Way to Fail. I hope you found this video useful and helpful, because there's a lot of shit and a lot of misinformation and crying and bitching all over the place and stuff that's based on feeling instead of based on the law and what's really happening. So if you need the too long didn't read version because you skipped to the end, here goes. If you're a YouTube content creator, it's time to strap in and lower those expectations. Things are going to get worse before they get better, if they ever get better. So the best you can do right now is toe the line, keep making content, and work towards creating a better tomorrow. Is that the answer you wanted to hear? I don't know, but hopefully I helped you cut through the bullshit. Take care.